Good morning again. Our sermon today is called World Shock, Nearly 600 Years of History Overturned. I'd like to begin by turning to a Bible text in 1 Corinthians chapter 12 and verse 32. Now, today's message is not going to be a sermon. Ellen White says that a congregation should not necessarily expect a sermon every Sabbath, so that's okay. It's not going to be a Bible study either. It's going to be something somewhere between. We're not going to have a sermon, but I may sermonize, and it won't be a Bible study, but we will have some Bible we're reading, but maybe we'll call it a thought study. In the First Chronicles chapter 12 and verse 32, talking about some of the men in the kingdom of David at the time, it says, "And the children of Issachar were men that had understanding of the times to know what Israel ought to do." If there was ever a time when we need people, beloved, who understand the times and what Israel ought to do, it's today. In the Review and Herald of August the 5th, 1902, Ellen White writing, she says, "Those who place themselves under God's control to be led and guided by Him will catch the steady trend of events ordained by Him to take place." There are events that are happening among us, and we need to have a proper perspective and a proper understanding of what those events are. Because if we fail to understand where we are and what's happening, then we will not be able to occupy the place and the position that God wishes for His people to have in these last days. I think probably everybody in this country is aware that last Monday, on February the 11th, that Pope Benedict XVI announced that coming this Thursday, the 28th of February at 8 p.m. Rome time, he's going to be resigning the office of the papacy. And the Pope gave rationale for this. In our next slide, Pope, and I'm quoting from the Pope's address, he says, "After having repeatedly examined my conscience before God, I have come to the certainty that my strengths, due to an advanced age, are no longer suited to an adequate exercise of the patrine ministry. In order to govern the bark of St. Peter and proclaim the gospel, both strength of mind and body are necessary, strength which the last few months has deteriorated in me to the extent that I have had to recognize my incapability to adequately fulfill the ministry entrusted to me." End quote. Now that's the Pope's explanation for why he is resigning his position. Interestingly, the Pope has been applauded for this position by many Catholics as well as Protestants. For example, in our next slide, we have Roland Martin, who is a CNN news contributor and analyst, and he said this, and I quote him, Pope Benedict shows true leadership by resigning. It takes courage, considerable courage rather, for anyone to step away from the power bestowed upon them by a position, as well as the trappings that come with it. We should acknowledge the value of an ego-less decision that reflects humility and concern about the very institution the Pope pledged his life to. That was what Roland Martin said from CNN. The failure of John Paul II, our next slide, the failure of John Paul II to be able to adequately govern the seat of the Bishop of Rome during his final years has been cited as an example of someone who should have stepped down long before he died. Benedict XVI is 85 years old, and so stating that one's health at such an age is an issue, to holding down this demanding job, in fact, perhaps one of the most demanding jobs of the world, it's not so far-fetched. It seems reasonable. Others, however, have overlooked the seeming innocence of the matter and have suggested that something far more sinister is involved in Benedict XVI's resignation. Some have suggested, and I speak with marked carefulness here, Some have suggested that Benedict resigned because of the severe problems of sexual abuse among the priests of the Catholic Church, and as head of the church, the final responsibility for these acts of the priest fall upon him. In other words, the buck stops here. Benedict's resignation, therefore, was to avoid being brought before a criminal trial or tribunal as head of the Catholic Church. Now, at this point in time, there's a good bit of material to wade through concerning this, some documented, some not. But we need to accurately determine what is truth. Now, there's no doubt that great and terrible abuse has occurred within the supposed sacred halls of the institution which calls itself the Church. Catholic leadership has acknowledged at all levels this problem, howbeit they do so at different degrees of acknowledgement. There is certainly evidence that Benedict has not been blind to the abuse, but there's also evidence that he was not a supporter of the abuse and even tried at one point to bring some of the worst offenders to some type of justice. For example, it was reported on May the 1st of 2010 that Benedict took control of the Legionnaires of Christ, a powerful and wealthy Roman Catholic religious order whose founder was a friend of Pope John Paul II, and this individual was found guilty of child molestation and molesting seminarians and even fathering children. And I don't think I put that slide there on there. But the Legionnaires of Christ was founded in 1941 by the Mexican priest Marcelo Miquel de Goledo. And while Ratzinger was still a cardinal and Pope John Paul II was still reigning, Ratzinger had tried to defrock Miquel, but Miquel was protected by John Paul II. And it reminds me of a text in Isaiah chapter 30. Isaiah chapter 30. And verse 1. Isaiah chapter 30, verse 1. It says, "Woe to the rebellious children, woe to the rebellious children, saith the Lord, that take counsel, but not of me, and that cover with a covering, but not of my spirit, that they may add sin to sin." You know, it's bad, friends, when we sin and we do grievous things, and it's also bad, it's also grievous when we try to cover up those things and to cover up for others. After becoming Pope, though, Benedict removed Miquel, but only symbolically slapped his wrists, as he was told, and I quote here from this BBC report, he was told to retire to a life of prayer and penitence. That's in slide 7 of our presentation today. This same BBC news report noted, and I will quote it, number 8, "The Pope himself has been accused of being a part of a culture of secrecy and of not taking strong enough steps against pedophiles when he had that responsibility as a cardinal in Rome. However," just leave this, that's fine. "However, his supporters say that he has been the most proactive pope yet in confronting abuse." And that reminds me of a Bible text in 2 Corinthians chapter 10 and verse 12. Paul says, "For we dare not make ourselves of the number or compare ourselves with some that commend themselves, but they measuring themselves by themselves and comparing themselves among themselves are" what? "They're not wise." In other words, what they're saying is that Benedict has done more than any other pope before him to try to deal with these kind of things. But what is that saying? Not much. Because what did the others do before him? They tried to cover up. So just because we say he's doing better doesn't mean that he's doing well or doing good. For Benedict has also been the center of controversy concerning other cases where little appears to have been done except the turning away of heads from wicked acts. And a case in point was priest Lawrence C. Murphy, who worked at a school for deaf children in Wisconsin from 1950 to 1974. And during that time, as many as 200 young boys were molested by Murphy. The New York Times reported, and this is from the Times, I quote to you from the Times, In the next slide, in 1996, Cardinal Ratzinger failed to respond to two letters about the case of Rembert G. About the case from Rembert G. Weakland, Milwaukee's Archbishop at the time. After 8 months, the second in command at the doctrinal office, Cardinal Tarsigio Bertone, now the Vatican's Secretary of State, instructed the Wisconsin bishops to begin a secret canonical trial that could lead to Father Murphy's dismissal. Next slide. But Cardinal Bertone halted the process after Father Murphy personally wrote to Cardinal Ratzinger, protesting that he should not be put on trial because he had already repented and was in poor health, and that the case was, get this, beyond the church's own statutes of limitations. And in that quote from the New York Times, we have here where Murphy is writing to Ratzinger, and he says, "I simply want to live out the time I have left in the dignity of my priesthood." Father Murphy wrote near the end of his life to Cardinal Ratzinger, "I ask your kind assistance in this matter." The files contain no response from Cardinal Ratzinger. And the Times published on the internet, still there available, a copy that they had obtained of Murphy's letter to Ratzinger. And in the second page, we have here part of it that we just quoted to you. He says, "I'm 72 years of age, Your Eminence. I'm in poor health. Please have pity upon me," in other words. I wonder how much pity he had upon those people, young boys that he molested. Now, while actual legal justice, might be very difficult to serve upon the Pope or to be held responsible for today, what he could be held responsible for today is probably very difficult to evaluate. There are some self-proclaimed tribunals, such as the International Tribunal into Crimes of Church and State. And they claim, and I will read their quote here, that court and tribunals derive their ultimate authority from the self-evident natural law which resides within the reason and compassion of every man and woman, and from the common law right of the informed citizenry to establish their own courts, policing, and laws when normal institutions fail or refuse to uphold their liberty, rights, safety, and well-being of the community. And that's from their own website. In other words, there's a self-proclaimed group here. They have no connection to any government, no connection to any civil power. They're not supported by any government. They're not supported by any civil power. They said, "We'll become a tribunal to ourselves. And we will decide if this man needs to be taken in. And we have police who will go get him if the other people won't." Now, currently, as a head of state, and this is important to know, as a head of state under international law, Benedict has immunity from prosecution. And those who say he's stepping down to avoid prosecution fail to see that he is at a greater danger of being prosecuted if he leaves his position as Pope, a position that assures him that Italy will not in any way try to interfere based upon, yes, right, the next slide, based upon the Lateran Treaty that was signed between Gasparri and Mussolini. You know, that treaty still has relevance today, friends. It sure does. Now, Reuters News, a very dependable news agency and the first to announce the Pope's resignation, reported this, interestingly. And I quote their news. And in fact, now they're quoting a Vatican official. His continued presence in the Vatican is necessary, otherwise he might be defenseless. He wouldn't have his immunity, his prerogatives, his security, if he is anywhere else, said one Vatican official, speaking on condition of autonomy. It is absolutely necessary that he stays in the Vatican, said the source, adding that Benedict should have a, quote, dignified existence, end quote, in his remaining years. Well, after all, he wanted Father Murphy to have a dignified, you know, end, so why can't he have one? Going on, the final key consideration is the Pope's potential exposure to legal claims over the Catholic Church's sexual abuse scandals. In 2010, for example, Benedict was named as a defendant in a lawsuit alleging that he failed to take action as a cardinal in 1995 when he was allegedly told about a priest who had abused boys at a U.S. school for the deaf decades earlier. Remember, we talked about that. He goes on. The lawyers withdrew the case last year, and the Vatican said it was a major victory that proved the Pope could not be held liable for the actions of abusive priests. Next slide. Benedict is currently not named specifically in any other case. The Vatican does not expect any more, but is not ruling out the possibility. When Benedict went to Britain in 2010, British author and atheist campaigner Richard Dawkins, some of you have heard Richard Dawkins, I think, asked authorities to arrest the Pope to face questions over the church's child abuse scandal. Dawkins, the next slide, Dawkins and the late British-American journalist Christopher Hitchens commissioned lawyers to explore ways of taking legal action against the Pope. Their efforts came to nothing because the Pope was a head of state and so enjoyed diplomatic immunity. And so the point being here, friends, is that the idea of the Pope resigning to get away from problems is probably not correct. Problems are there, but as the head of the state, he will receive immunity, diplomatic immunity, and he cannot be touched. And further, as long as he stays in the Vatican as a former head of state, he will probably not be touchable. And this is why his plans have changed, and he's now going to stay at the Vatican. You see. Now, I understand, according to the Lateran Treaty, he will be able to go out for visits into Rome if he needs to, and still keep his diplomatic immunity. But he can't just go out to stay, he can't go out to another country and expect to have that immunity. But while he stays in the Vatican, he can have it. I want to talk to you about what's coming up. Benedict XVI's resignation is quite a newsworthy event since the Pope has not resigned since the Protest and Reformation began. In fact, Benedict is only the third Pope to resign the office and only the second to do so voluntarily. Not since 1415, when Pope Gregory the 12th resigned, has a Pope resigned or was forced to step down. The only other time a Pope willingly resigned was in 1294, when Pope Celestine the 5th resigned. This is actually his corpse. They display these corpses of the popes periodically at different times in the Vatican. When I was there, the last time I was there, they were displaying Pope John the 23rd. So he's been around for a while. Now, the current Vatican protocol for the timing of choosing a new pope after the office has become vacant, was actually decided by John Paul II. And we have here one of his papal decrees. And of course, you know, being as they consider God on earth, being as they consider he's infallible, he can state about whatever he wants and it becomes law. And here's what John Paul had decided. He says, I furthermore decree that from the moment when the apostolic see is lawfully vacant, the cardinal electors who are present must wait 15 full days for those who are absent. The College of Cardinals is also granted the faculty to defer, for serious reasons, the beginning of the election for a few more days. But when a maximum of 20 days have elapsed from the beginning of the vacancy of the see, all the cardinal electors present are obligated to proceed to the election. And so, under this rule, the process cannot start until sometime after March 15. However, the Vatican announced on February the 20th that Benedict is considering changing or modifying the process so that the conclave can begin earlier, perhaps by Sunday, March the 10th, with the hope that a new pope would be chosen and installed the following Sunday, March the 17th, and thus the new pope would be in place for the upcoming Easter season. If you remember back during the conclave that elected Benedict, I believe it only lasted 4 days or a couple days. It was a very short conclave. Now, the meeting to elect the Pope is called a conclave. Conclave is a word that means a place that is locked. It's from the Latin word clavus, meaning key. They meet at of course, the Vatican, right by St. Peter's. You have what's called the Sistine Chapel. And they will meet locked in the Sistine Chapel during the day for these deliberations. There will be a morning and afternoon vote taken each day. The best we can calculate right now, there will be 117 electors, cardinals that are under the age of 80 years at this conclave. Of this 117, 61 of them are European, a very slim majority. There's much speculation that a cardinal from the third world or a third world country might be chosen. Over half the cardinals that are going to be at this conclave have been handpicked by Benedict already. They were made cardinals under his papacy. The rest were made cardinals under the reign of John Paul II. So every cardinal there will be from either Benedict or John Paul II, both very conservative in their thinking, Catholic-wise, and therefore it is reasonable to expect that the new pope will be conservative in nature and supportive of Benedict's and John Paul's positions on abortion, contraception, and women's ordination to the priesthood. During the time of the conclave, the cardinals will stay at the Vatican and have no communication with the outside world, no radios, no telephones, no newspapers, and not even the internet will be available to them. Paper ballots are given to the cardinals, each with the Latin words imprinted, Ergo in summum pontificem, which means in Latin, I elect as supreme pontiff, and then they're supposed to put the name of the person that they are choosing. The protocol calls for a two-thirds majority, and they will stay and vote until that happens, or possibly until the 31st vote when a simple majority will be allowed to carry. Now, I want to talk to you about some of the possible successors quickly, because succession as to whom the next pope will be is always abounds before the conclaves begin. There are even betting establishments that are offering odds on who the next pope will be. Some of the leading candidates, perhaps the leading candidate, is Peter Turkson. Another candidate is Cardinal Francis Arens, and then also Cardinal Mark Ouellette from Canada. Turkson, 64, is a Guyanan cardinal of the Catholic Church. He is the president of the Pontifical Council for Justice and Peace since his appointment by Pope Benedict XVI on October 24, 2009. He has served as the Archbishop of Cape Coast, and Turkson has been vocal and critical concerning the sexual scandals within the church, and he has stated, and if I could go up to slide number 29, we have his statement, African traditional systems kind of protect or have protected its population against this tendency, and that tendency is for the sexual abuse of the priests. He says, because in several communities, in several cultures in Africa, homosexuality, or for that matter, any affair between two sexes of the same kind, are not countenanced in our society. So that culture taboo, that tradition has been there, it has served to keep it out. And that's what he said about that. Cardinal Francis Arens is 80 years old. Turkson is 64, but now Arens is 80, and he is an Igbo Nigerian cardinal. He is prefect emeritus of the Congregation for Divine Worship and the Discipline of the Sacraments, having served as the prefect from 2002 to 2008. Arens was a principal advisor to Pope John Paul II and was considered papable before the last conclave when Benedict XVI was elected. The term papable means someone that they believe is very suited and likely to be chosen to be pope. There are some cardinals that they don't feel would be papable. They probably wouldn't fit, very little support behind them. They don't call them papable. But Arens is considered papable as he was during the last election. And though his age is against him, Benedict was also elected when near an octogenarian mark. And then we have Cardinal Ouellette from Canada, from Quebec, Canada. He is of the Society of St. Sulpice, and he is the present prefect of the Congregation for Bishops and concurrently president of the Pontifical Commission for Latin America since his appointment by Benedict on June 30 of 2010. Of interest to note, none of the three leading candidates are European. However, it is well to consider that only four papal candidates have been elected pope in the last century. So it's the kind of thing that you have an idea, but don't put your money on it, friends, because we don't know. So I'm not going to spend any more time on it. I'm just telling you, these are some people who might be considered. Now, with the resignation of the pope, prophetic interpretation wheels have begun to spin at supersonic speed, and some have taken a look backward in an effort to look forward. And it's really maybe because of some of the things that I've been hearing that I've been prompted to want to tell you some of these things and to investigate this myself and to try to understand where we are in this stream of time. In 1983, in our next slide, if we go to slide 31, 30, in 1983, Dr. Robert Hauser created a stir within Adventism when he published his book, Give Glory to Him, The Sanctuary, in the book of Revelation. While not rejecting the historical interpretation of early Adventists, the historical scheme of prophecy that Adventists had used for years, he declared, and I quote to you from his book on page 2, that that interpretation, like the horse and buggy, no longer fits our needs. Hauser proposes that Revelation has multiple fulfillments and that we need to look to a future fulfillment using the scheme of futurism for direction for the last days. Now, of widespread interest is his interpretation of Revelation 17, verses 10 and 11. So let's turn to Revelation chapter 17, verses 10 and 11. It says, "And there are seven kings, five are fallen, and one is, and the other is not yet come. And when he cometh, he must continue a short space. And the beast that was and is not, even he is the eighth, and is of the seven, and goeth into perdition." Hauser understood the time setting of this prophecy to be in the last days when the Vatican would be restored as a kingdom, specifically pointing to the time of the Lateran Treaty between Italy and the Vatican that Gasparri and Mussolini signed. The kings here represent popes who would reign after the Vatican became a sovereign state again. And Hauser in his book notes them. And these are the popes: Pope Pius the 11th, Pius the 12th, John the 23rd, Paul the 6th, John Paul the 1st. And he gives the length of their reigns. And then Hauser says, five are fallen. And he puts that in all capital letters with those exclamation points. Five are fallen. He's making a point of that. The one reigning during the writing of the book, Give Glory to Him, was Pope John Paul II. The seventh pope would be the one to reign for a short time. This would have to be Benedict the 16th. Hauser, however, stated, and I will read to you his statement from page 233 of his book, "John Paul II will not die until during or after the martyrdom of many Sabbath keepers following the passage of the Sunday law." Now, that sort of failed, don't you think? Could we judge that prophecy has failed? I think so. Or his interpretation, I should say, the prophecy has failed. This part of Hauser's interpretation clearly has failed to come to pass. Further, Hauser believed that Satan's personating Christ would occur during the short reign of the eighth pope, and I quote him here. He says, "The pope to follow John Paul II will continue a short space. If you will refer back to the charts on page 80 and 105, you will see that it is probably less than a year from the last of the martyrs until Satan's counterfeiting of Christ's return, a short space. The appearance of Satan personating Christ fulfills verse 11. The beast that was and is not, even he is the eighth king. When Satan personates Jesus and places his blessing on the Pope, the vicar of Christ, the pontiff will bow Satan's feet and, the pontiff will bow Satan's feet, and Satan thus becomes the eighth in succession of kings as a Vatican City. He is of the seven and goes into perdition." Now, the only way that this could be fulfilled would be between now and Thursday night. Satan comes back personating as Christ, while Benedict is still in office, and he hands the scepter over to him. Well, that still has a small window to happen, but based upon the earlier part, I don't think it's going to happen. But since Hauser's interpretation of this vital prophecy has failed, why do I bring it up now? What is its significance now? It's because Hauser's work has spawned off variations that as of today still have a small window of probation before they too will be proven wrong. The most notable of this interpretation is by a group of Adventists that have a website called World's Last Chance, slide number 35. You see their home page there. And in their website they make this statement on slide 36. It's quoted from the study of Revelation 13 and 17. we can conclude only one who constitutes the best personality for achieving Satan's end time agenda. It is John Paul II the Great. And what they're saying is, well, we'll come up to it in a minute, but they're saying that John Paul II has to be involved in this, but they're claiming it's not really John Paul, it's a devil, not Satan, but a devil, who will impersonate a resurrected John Paul II. And he will take the place of Benedict XVI. And they're gambling on this. They're betting on this. This is what they say is going to happen. And I guess I probably should put more of the quote in here to make that clear, but that's what they say is going to happen, that the Pope Benedict, who is the one who's going to be here for a short time, and I think that's ironic because if you go back to the chart, you know that there were two of those other popes before him since the Lateran Treaty who actually reigned shorter than he did. So he didn't reign such a short time compared to some of the others. But they're saying that before Benedict resigns, or at that point, John Paul II will be resurrected and Benedict will hand the scepter over to him and he will then reign as the new pope, John Paul II the Great. Now I ask a question, you know, and maybe you haven't heard this, but I assure you, this buzz is going around and you're going to get more and more emails. Someone's already, yeah, you're going to get emails telling you all about these things, and there's others too. I'm not done, believe me. How did we come to such a place where there were such interpretations within Adventism? I want to tell you it's because there have been those who have abandoned the historicist principle of interpretation for what a person by the name of Desmond Ford calls the apostolomatic principle. Have you ever heard of Desmond Ford, any? I think some of us have. And you may have heard about his theology on the sanctuary son, but what you need to understand is that the basis behind what he's really been doing with his sanctuary theology is based upon a concept that he calls the apostolomatic principle. And that is, and I will let him explain it, in his manuscript, Daniel 8:14, The Day of Atonement, the Investigative Judgment, he says this. The apostolomatic principle is a convenient term for referring to the concept that a particular prophecy in outline or as regards a dominant feature may have more than one application in time. In other words, dual interpretations, multiple interpretations, and the key phrase here is more than one application in time. Ford is suggesting multiple interpretations. In fact, in his book Daniel, slide 39, he says, it must be said that each of the systems is right in what it affirms and wrong in what it denies. Now, what is he talking about? What is he saying is right in what it refers and wrong in what it denies? What are these systems he's talking about? Well, Ford in his book explains and discusses these systems of interpretations. And the first is a system called preterism. And that says simply that this views all the prophecies as having been fulfilled prior to or soon after the beginning of the Christian era. This system of interpretation was developed by the Jesuit Alcazar as part of the Catholic Counter-Reformation movement. Did you get that? This concept of preterism was developed by the Jesuits. But you'll excuse me if my mind was a little ahead of speed there, because the next one we're going to talk about is also a Jesuit interpretation, and that is futurism. This system is developed also by a Jesuit. His name was Ribera. He was a Spanish Jesuit. And with this method of understanding, it is said that most, if not all, apocalyptic prophecy is to be fulfilled at some future time after a so-called secret rapture. This too was a part of the counter-reformation movement of the Catholic Church, and sadly this scheme of interpretation and understanding has become the standard among evangelical apostate Protestants today. The third scheme of interpretation is historicism, or to be historic in your understanding, and it teaches that history is simply the response to the voice of prophecy. This system was used by the Protestants during the Reformation and was the basis for the understanding of prophecy in the Advent movement. Now the fourth system, and this is the one that Ford likes, is the apostolomatic principle. And this principle teaches that a given prophecy, such as the little horn of Daniel 8, could have been fulfilled by Antiochus Epiphanes in 167 BC for fulfillment of preterism. Then this same prophecy could find another fulfillment or another application in the New Testament times in the papacy, thus giving it a historical fulfillment. But finally, it could apply to a future Antichrist to appear near the end of time, fulfilling the futuristic scheme. Ford even suggests in his book Daniel, if the apostolic principle were to be widely understood, I'm on slide 44, if the apostolic principle were to be widely understood, some differences between the systems would be automatically resolved. Well, what does he mean about that? Automatically resolve differences. What he is suggesting is that if we have a compromise with Jesuit interpretations, that this would help us. And it is a mingling of truth and error together. And he says this is the answer for God's people. And I say, how dare we accept such a damnable idea? One Bible student noted, the bottom line is an attempt to adulterate the historic Advent faith, which was built upon the prophecies of God, which was built upon the prophecies of God's word, by which the events of history were seen as the unfolding of the scroll of prophecy. Now, I'm not saying that no prophecy in the Bible anywhere has any kind of a second or dual application, but some do have a general nature, and I want to explain that how, and I'm going to quote here. Tell me if that went to number 46. Okay. For example, Jesus told his disciples on the Mount of Olives that nation should rise against nation and kingdom against kingdom, and great earthquakes shall be in divers places, and famines and pestilence, and fearful sights and great signs shall there be from heaven. Luke 21:10-11. This prophecy of Jesus could have multiple applications, but it is a general prophecy. In other words, nations against nations, that's been happening over and over and over. The same night, Jesus also informed the disciples that Jerusalem would be compassed with armies. By this, they would then know that the desolation thereof was nigh, Luke 21:20. This is a specific prophecy and finds only one fulfillment in all history. If it were to have multiple applications, how then would the ones for whom the prophecy was given know when to do what Jesus instructed them to do when the event occurred? And that was, I like the way that was said. That was from the late William Grothier's Watchman While the Night, January of 1985. One might wish to argue that we can use Jesuit means of interpretation to still come up with the right answer. But I dare say, friends, it would be like trying to build an octagon house on a square foundation. You know, whatever type of foundation you start with is going to a great degree, determine the kind of house you can build. Isn't that right? And so our prophetic hermeneutics, friends, are the tools that we have, is the tool that we have with exegesis to understand what the prophecy means. But when we start with the wrong principles of understanding, it's virtually impossible to come up with the right answers later. Now, very soon, there's going to be a new pope elected or chosen, or something's going to happen within this week, or the week after, possibly. And what's going to happen? Well, we're going to find out. We can speak with positiveness concerning prophecy that's been fulfilled, but as Elder White said, with the things that are still yet not happened, we speak with a little bit of humility. But there's one more point I want to make or bring to us. And that's one more refurbished old look. And did it come up there? We have the prophecy of Saint Malachy. And Saint Malachy lived from 1094 on, and he was the Archbishop of Armagh. And he was reported to have had several miracles attributed to him, and he was purported to have a vision of 112 popes. This vision became known as the prophecy of the popes. Malachy was canonized by Pope Clement III in 1199. Now, the text that has been attributed to Malachy surfaced in the year 1595. Get that date? 1595. In a book by a Benedictine monk, Arnold D. Wyon, Malachy was supposed to have experienced a vision of future popes during a trip to Rome in the year 1139. Now, he's had this vision supposedly in the year 1139, but it doesn't surface until the year 1595. Okay, so we got over 450 years here or so between them. And in this vision, he was supposedly had, he wrote down a series of 112 cryptic phrases that describe each pope in turn. The text was supposed to have been restored or stored in the Roman archives, for for over 450 years until Wyon published it. Interestingly, the Catholic Church believes the document is a forgery. Did you know that? They don't believe it. One of the problems with the document is the understanding of these cryptic phrases, because for the first 450 years of these phrases, in other words, until the time they were discovered, there seems to be a remarkably accurate fulfillment in each of the popes. But after that time, it's like you've got to search high and low to try to figure out a connection between the pope and the cryptic phrase. This is very clear evidence of a forgery. And further, I ask a question, friends. Does God generally work this way? Does he generally send a prophet out of Babylon to teach God's people what the end times are going to be like? It just doesn't make sense. And I could go into some specific examples. The first pope that was mentioned in the prophecy, Celestine II, his cryptic phrase was from a castle of the Tiber. And Celestine II was born in Città Castello, a city that sits on the Tiber. And so very close, very remarkable, it seems. But when you get past those first 450 years into the last part of the prophecies, it's very hard to find anything. There is a prophecy about Benedict, or the pope that's in Benedict's place, and it's simply called Glory of the Olive. Glory of the Olive. And this has been understood by those who believe in this prophecy to be a fulfillment in Ratzinger, because he chose the name after Saint Benedict of Nursia, founder of the Benedictine order, of which the Olivetans are one branch. However, Ratzinger claimed to have chosen the name Benedict first because Pope Benedict XV. Ratzinger said, I wanted to be called Benedict XVI in order to create a spiritual bond with Benedict XV, who steered the church through the period of turmoil caused by the First World War. And that's from a general audience he gave after he became Pope. But he also stated, and I will, in fairness, give the next statement, he also said the name Benedict was also called to mind the extraordinary figure of the great patriarch of Western monasticism, Saint Benedict of Nursia, co-patron of Europe. So Benedict does mention Saint Benedict of Nursia, but the Olivetans, whose symbol is the olive, is simply one branch of the Benedictine order. The last pope in the prophecy is said to be Peter the Roman. Now, popes are not allowed to choose the name Peter. They can choose any name they want, except Peter. You will never find in the list of popes Peter the Second, Peter the Third, Peter the Fourth. There's only one Peter. So this new one is going to be called Peter the Roman. Any pope can do that because they first of all, they can't use the name Pope, name Peter, but they can say, well, we're sitting in the seat of Peter at where? At Rome. Now, of course, there's been a little extra speculation because of Peter Turkson. They said, well, if he's chosen, his name already is Peter. We'll wait and see how that goes. But according to the prophecy, this last pope that will come after Benedict, he will be the last, and he will pasture his sheep in many tribulations, with the city of Seven Hills being destroyed at the end. And most people consider those city of Seven Hills to be, of course, Rome. Now, all the different views on the current papal succession cannot, of course, be right. But in one sense, they have something in common about them that is perhaps accurate, and that is that they are all pointing to a swift end. And I think that if we are alert of what's happening in our world, we certainly are coming to the very end, and the end is swift, and the end is sure. But the exact details we may not know yet. Now, in John chapter 3, is a statement of Jesus that has meant a lot to me, especially in concerning unfulfilled prophecy. John chapter 3. Well, isn't that where Jesus talked to Nicodemus about salvation? Sure is. But in John chapter 3 and verse 11, Jesus said to him, verily, verily, I say unto thee, we speak that which we speculate on. We speak that which we can guess. No, he says, we speak that which we know. You know, friends, we need to be careful about speculation at points like this in the history, because we can start speculating, we go down the wrong vein, the wrong track, and we get people misled, and then things don't happen according to the way they're expecting it. They get discouraged, and they leave everything, or they just say, well, you know, the coming of the Lord isn't near. You said it was just going to be here. You said it was going to be under this pope. It could be years, centuries, millennia into the future. Forget all this sin coming stuff. Friends, we can't let that happen. We can't let that happen. While the Bible and the spirit of prophecy and history is our guide, with those things as our guide, we may use the tools of exegesis and hermeneutics, but when we go no further than these tools can take us at any given time, then only worthless guessation, that's my word, guessation, is left. Now the Bible speaks about two great mysteries. That's right. It speaks about the mystery of godliness in 1 Timothy chapter 3, 16. Great is the mystery of godliness, God manifest in the flesh. This concept that Jesus Christ would become incarnate and that there would be a blending of the human and the divine together. This is the gospel, friends. This is the essence of the gospel. And that's why in Revelation chapter 10 and verse 7, it says that the seventh angel will sound until, what? The mystery of God shall be finished. There's going to be a finishing of this mystery of God when God's people are sealed and when the gospel has done its work and when divinity has again been blended with humanity and Christ in you, Colossians 1:27, the hope of glory, has been realized in your life personally. But there's another mystery. And in Revelation 17, we have mystery Babylon the Great. And in 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 7, we have this mystery of iniquity. And we have two different things vying for each other. And we're either going to be involved with the mystery of iniquity or with the mystery of godliness. And I can stand here today and I can honestly tell you, I don't know exactly what's going to happen on Thursday at 8:01 this coming week. 8:01 p.m. I don't know what's going to happen. I don't know what's going to happen Friday. I don't know what's going to happen next Sabbath. And I'm not sure what's going to happen the week or two after, except something's going to happen. But the point I want to make is, I can know every detail perfectly. Let's say I can figure it out prophetically. But if I don't have a way of escape, it's like being on an island. Here comes a tsunami and you're watching it coming in at you. But what are you going to do? You know it's coming, but what are you going to do? You don't have any place to run. You don't have any place to hide. Spiritually, friends, if we're not in Christ, we don't have any place to go. We don't have any place to hide. And so we can know everything perfectly, but if we fail to know the thing, then we're still lost. On the other hand, if I don't fully understand everything yet, as long as I'm abiding in Christ, then I have the strength, the fortitude, and the ability to handle whatever crisis will come in whatever manner God sends it. 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 18. Paul says, "But we all with open face, beholding as in a glass the glory of the Lord, are changed into the same image from glory to glory, even as by the Spirit of the Lord." As we are beholding Christ, we will become changed. You know, Jesus said that there be people in the end time. In Luke 21, he speaks about men's hearts failing them for what?
Fear.
For fear. Why? For looking on the things coming on the earth. And yet, as students of prophecy, we need to know what's coming on to a degree, right? I mean, we have to have some knowledge of this. But friends, there's a difference because those people of the world, they don't have Christ. And they're fearful. And they are not going to be able to stand in that time. But we can stand if we're in Christ. If we've been beholding him, Paul says in Hebrews 12:2, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith. And so as we look to Jesus, as we trust in him, as we placing our experience in Christ, we would become like him. And it is a point of human nature, the way God has made us, and he's intentionally made us like this, because he made us to behold his face. We will become like what we view. We'll become like what we study. And so this is one reason, friends, it's so important we be very careful what we watch, what we hear, what we see, what we study. You know, people who want to dabble into evolution just to find out what it's teaching, be very careful. I don't recommend that for any reason. We don't need to know error to understand truth, friends. You may have heard of Daniel Day Lewis. He's played the character of Abraham Lincoln in Steven Spielberg's movie that was released last year called Lincoln. And it said that Day-Lewis spent over a year preparing for this part, just trying to understand Lincoln, to try to perfect the voice that he believed was Lincoln's, to try to perfect his mannerisms. He studied Lincoln for over a year. He spent a year of his life to prepare for this one film. And we as Christians, friends, we're preparing not for one film. We're not preparing for acting. We're not preparing for a short period of time. We're preparing for what? Eternity. And it demands more than a year of our time. It demands exactly however many minutes you have left on this earth. Because sanctification is not the work of a moment, but it's the work of what? A lifetime. Friends, if you don't feel like I'm there yet today, that's okay. You don't have to be there today yet, but you should be where you're supposed to be today. Right? You should be where you're supposed to be today. And tomorrow, by God's grace, God will bring you down a little step closer. And tomorrow, the day after that, a little closer. And He knows, friends. He knows the days that we have left. And if I'm abiding in Him, He will not allow my life to be cut off 1 second sooner than what I need to be ready to be in His eternal kingdom. Whether it's through accident, some kind of an injury, or disease, He is able to hold me, and He's able to sustain me. And He's able to hold and sustain you too. But we cannot presumptuously disregard the opportunities He gives us. We have to make use of this time. Now is the time to be preparing for eternal life. Now is the time to be holding Jesus, so that no matter what comes up in the events of the next few weeks, months, or year, and I don't know how long all this is going to last. You know, these people have these prophetic charts, and they've got it out almost to the day. This is going to happen. The National Sunday Law, so many days. And you know, by the way, those charts, and they're in Hauser's book too, by the way. Those charts are all based on futurism. You need to know that. They're based upon futurism and the principle, the apostolic principle of multiple interpretations, because we know what the historic understanding of those is. And many of those people like Hauser, they don't deny that. They don't say that was wrong. They just say it doesn't fit our needs today. It's like a horse and buggy. We can do better. And I don't think we're going to do better at all, friends, accepting Jesuit principles of Bible understanding to know what God's Word has for this last day. Let's be students, like you say. Let's look into Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith. Thank you, and God bless.